Okay, so I've been a student, and I've been a teacher, and I've been a teacher of fifth standard students. So I know how does it feel like to sit in a lecture and to listen to any talk, right? So we'll start with one activity. Yeah, we're going to start reflecting on our own experiences with the education that we had. You can see books, right? All of you, please close your eyes. You can raise your right hand. My first question for you: whatever things that you learn in your kindergarten, think about things that you learned in your kindergarten, LKG, UKG. How much of the things that you learned are useful to you right now? If it is completely useful to you, show me a 5. Partially useful to you, show me a 3. If it is not at all useful for you, show me a 1. Okay. Let's move a bit further. Think about the things that you learned in your primary education, like standard 1 to 5. The basics of things, the different languages that you learn. Great. Let's move a bit further as well. Let's move to your secondary education, things that you learned from your 6th standard to 10th standard. If it is completely useful to you, show me a 5. Okay? Let's see a bit more. Let's move a bit more. Let's go to your higher secondary education, like grade 11 and 12. You learned different things. You learned new concepts. You learned the PCM subjects. It's an engineering education, right? Okay? Please open your eyes. Look around. Look around. You can continue showing your hands. Look around. Okay. Different people are at different paces. Put your hands down. Thank you so much for engaging on this activity. The reason that I've asked you to do this particular thing is I always feel the relevance or the things that we learn have drastically reduced over years. It can be different for different people, but in my particular feeling, the things that we learn in our primary education was the basics. Like, as we keep on moving, I felt that the education is not personalized to us. It was not customized to us, though we are the end customers, and it was like a standardized one. Like, it can be, it is the same for everyone. We have to go through a standardized thing. That's the reason I've asked you to reflect on your own experiences. Now, let me begin with the talk. So I had this opportunity to travel to Canada to receive this IEEE Meritorious Achievement Award in pre-university education. So I was invited to Vancouver to attend the award ceremony. I also used the opportunity to stay in Canada for around 15 days and explore the country. So I went to from the east end to the west end. I've touched upon like 4 different states along with my friends. And it was a lot of learning experiencing one of the most difficult temperatures, like minus 20 degrees Celsius when we were in Yellowknife. So by that time, it was a lot of learning for me. One, it was a lot of adventure. Second, it was a lot of learning. Have you ever wondered why do you have packets on your, formal trousers? You have packets, right? Have you ever wondered it? I always had the question because when I'm actually trying to put my hand within that packet, like the people in the personality, development, they used to say, you're hiding something from someone. So don't put your hands within your packets. Then why does the packet exist? So that's the question that came to my mind. When I went to Canada, I realized like it's extreme cold. You have to put your hands within your pockets because else it will be like completely frozen. And also, I'm very fascinated about hoodie, like the hoodie, the thing that you wear, right? It's a very trend. It's on trend right now. I also wondered why do we need a hoodie? Why do we need something to cover up your head? Then I realized after going there, when you walk outside, it will be like completely snow, and you need a hoodie. And also, I learned about different things like the so-called formal wear, the business attire, right? So we wear tie, we wear shoes. All these things are contextual or relevant to that particular place. It is a need of that particular place. That is the reason for why they do what they do on that particular place. And when I came back to India, I realized like the cultural wear, the so-called cultural wear that we have, is not a cultural wear. It is a contextual wear that we have. It is created with the spirit of having comfort for us, but we actually started following up them. Just seeing them doing all these things, we never realized whether it's a context for us, and we started doing them. That's when I realized the power of this particular world called context. The circumstances which sets a setting for any idea or for any statement or for any event that happens. So now I started looking at things in a much more contextual way. Then I started looking at the Indian education system, whether whatever that we follow is contextual. So to look at the Indian education system, we have to go a bit back in time to the early history. In India, when we started education, it was more with the spirit of Guru Shishya Parambarya. It was the transfer of knowledge and skills to the disciples, not by any means of school, not by any forcing, but in what is a way of living. The disciples are, completely committed towards learning. They spend their entire 10 to 12 years of time in the Gurukula learning different things. So this is how it all started. And then we actually moved into the Middle Ages. When by the time we had a lot of invasions, we had Mughals, we had different people who are coming up into the country, and they started changing the education system in a weird way. But still, it was really wonderful to note the King Akbar, right? He also wants the people to learn something in their own language or in their own religious. So even though he's a Mughal emperor, he ensured that all the people who are learning also learn the different religions that they are following. So that's what happened in the Middle Ages. Then this thing happened. All the European countries, they started having their colonies in India, and especially this British and French. So what happened in the British period in 1835, the popular thing of the English Education Act came into picture with the work of Mr. Macaulay. And what he did was, they wanted completely, they wanted an English-based education system which drives the entire learning. So they didn't talk about any skills, they didn't talk about any knowledge. They only wanted the people to learn literacy. So literacy was at the core of it. And the education system, which was completely composed of skills, very, very fine skills. So India has one of the most rich in terms of the arts and culture. Everything was taken away, and we were forced to take up this particular thing and follow the same. And post-independence happened. We actually, though a lot of things changed, the education system that we followed, haven't changed. We got a lot of technical institutes, we got IITs, we got NITs, but still, literacy was the core of it, and still we feel success as something related to literacy. Like in the 2011 census, the literacy of India is 74%. We feel that it has grown a lot, and we felt that as a success, where the actual, when it originated, it was all about values, and now it has moved to literacy and reading and writing. Yes. So then I started looking at some of the global countries which are doing exceptionally well in education. Like it's based on, I've chosen four countries based on something called as Global Competitiveness Index, which was given by the World Economic Forum. What exactly happened was, I was looking at all these countries, and like a few things really got stuck me. For example, in Finland, the education minister bravely says, the best school in the country is a school which is near to your house. Okay, today students are traveling across cities. Today students are traveling a lot. Like, the education minister says the school which is near to your home, it is the best school because you can go there, you can come back, you can have a lot of time, right? Second country I was looking at was Switzerland. What happened with Switzerland is they are the mecca of international hospitality. Think about their context. Like a lot of tourists come to that particular place, and them being able to offer education and hospitality makes a lot of sense because the students can practically work and learn from that experience. When I was looking at Belgium, they started giving offer to students at the age of 12. From the age of 12, you can take up anything that and take up as a higher study. Like you can take up an art, you can take up a technical education, you can take up a vocational education. Then looking at this country, interesting country, Singapore, very close to our India as well. So Singapore, 65% of the people who are learning, they are learning vocational education. So they are learning skills. They are not prioritizing anything else. They want to acquire skills and to be a very strong workforce for their nation. So this is my context and my idea of global education. So why am I telling all this is what gave me a spark? Any of you can identify this? What is this? All of us have studied this. So this is the digestive system of cockroach. Which I studied in the age of 12 when I was studying 7th standard. This was in the science textbook. I was reaching out to my mom and asking her, like, I'm not going to study this at all. I don't like cockroaches. I'm very afraid of them. I don't feel like reading this. Then she's like, no, it's in your syllabus. You have to read this. If this is your syllabus, you have to go and pursue that. There's no other way. Then I changed, like, how can I change this? Then she told me, you can change this only when you become an educator. When you understand the different policies of why this particular thing exists on the science book, that's the reason behind it. You have to identify that, and then you have to change that. Yes, so this was an interesting challenge that was posed to me by my mom, and I felt like that gave me a spark. But I ended up reading this. I ended up writing this on the examination, but I found no purpose of it because I'm not into biology, or I'm not a very big fan of cockroaches as well. So, and then this happened after like 10 years when I was completing my computer science education. I had the opportunity to go to either a corporate to continue with my field of interest, the computer science, or I can take up education. So I was taking up this fellowship with Teach for India when I was teaching grade 4 and 5 5th standard students for a period of 2 years, full time. My classroom is named as Design Thinkers. This is based on the design thinking, the feel, imagine, do, share, the problem solving methodology. And by this time, I was learning a lot of things to more than whatever that I teach to them. Because these students are from a really challenging community, and they actually posed me different questions. So when I was teaching them something from the textbook, they actually connected with whatever that they're experiencing in their community, and they'll ask me questions. So one, I worked a number of technology projects with them. We created a website for our classroom. The students participated in many competitions related to technology, arts, and things like that. So one day what happened is, I'm a very big fan of Google Maps. So all of us use it, and I was showing them the Google map of New York and Sydney. So different places. I was showing them, and they also asked me to show their place of origin, which is the MGR Nagar. So they belong to the MGR Nagar community. When I was showing them the MGR Nagar community, they had a question. Sir, I can see all the different places, they were so aligned, they are so labeled. Then I told them, like, they had a good town planning. They were recent countries, so they had a good planning. Maybe because our country is existing for a long time, we couldn't change the street, which is going in different angles to state, right? So I told them this, and then they told me, not that, sir. I'm thinking about the things, about the places. If you look at New York, every shop is marked. But when you look into an MGR Nagar community, we don't have anything. Even the streets are marked in the wrong way. So they got really angry. Then I told them, okay, we can do this thing. All the thing that happens in a Google map is not contributed by Google or someone. It's about the people who are working across the world who actually work towards change it. It's called Google Local Gates. So I introduced Google the concept of mapping to them, and I told them, like, you can also do something like that. You won't believe, within the matter of 2 weeks, the entire MGR Nagar community was marked, and more than 60 plus edits was approved by Google with the work of 5th standard students. So all these things actually brought me the idea of context to me. Like, they are learning technology, they are learning new thing, but still they are able to apply their context and to see how this technology can be used. So that gave me a different perspective altogether. And one of the things which I always feel that we are lacking is focus. Like, we are learning too many number of things. We are learning as many subjects as possible with different units and with different topics, and we are reading different books written by different authors. But one thing that we miss is we don't identify one strong strength of us and continuously focusing on that. Think about this. You're also doing engineering. So if you focus on one particular skill, say web development, for 4 years, you learn, you do websites, you understand different websites, you will be the master of it by the end of 4 years. But what really happens is we end up reading 42 different subjects at scale, but we don't have a depth of any one skill or topic. And when you go and approach for a job placement, they look for experienced people. So this education, which has to give the experience, they are only showing the glimpse of it, but we don't get the depth of anything. And then, but when you go to the work environment, they look for experienced people. So that's something that I always feel is lacking with the Indian education. So what happens is we do the 8 hours of formal education. We learn a lot of time. We sit in the school, but we don't learn something what we need. For example, if I want to pursue a Bharatanatyam, I have to go and do it after my school hours. And if I'm studying a 10th standard or 12th standard, after my tuition hours. Yeah? If I have to learn, if I have to do a sport, I have to do it after my school hours. If I have to, for me, I was volunteering with IEEE, and I'm very passionate about web development. So I started doing website for my student branch chapter, and I have to do it in the free time that I had, not in the actual working time, right? So if we learn every skill, if we learn something that we are passionate about only in the free time that we have, not in the formal learning time, then what's the purpose of it? So that's the question that I always have. If we give the students a time to explore different things, they can do something that they're passionate, and then they can learn on their own. So another interesting thing which I feel we miss in our education is the values. I can go and give a lecture to a lot of students. So I usually talk about values like compassion, empathy, how to take care of others, how to really help others, all these things. But what happens the next period if I go, the next teacher comes, when she started giving the progress report, all these values go off. Because you have to be the best. You have to be the first one. Now this is the problem. When we are talking about holistic education, when we are talking about students having the passion and interest to learn, they should feel the, they should get a feel of collaboration and not competition. Here we are running towards something. The education that we have is used as a filter. It's like testing a product, if it is a good or bad, you're a pass or a fail. Like, but we all are individual beings. We all have our own talents. We all have our own passion, our own interest. If we actually being tested whether as a yes or a no, it's not appropriate. So we have to cultivate a lot of values on the students through education, which can be done. If we actually show them the problems, if we show them the different people who are suffering from the problems, if we give them the tools, if they go and solve all these things, then they'll learn something called as values. India has 29 states. 29 states full of diversity. We have a desert, we have a vast ocean, we have whatnot, we have everything. We have rainforest, we have different things. If we actually identify what each and every state requires, if we actually identify what each and every small town requires, and if we educate the students based on that, we'll have 29 different methods of education. And this particular 29 education can serve the 195 countries in the world. I'm very sure on this because we are the only country with so much of diversity and so much of human resource. Even if some other country wants to try this, they'll be, they won't have the sufficient number of students. So we are the youngest country, and if we actually contextualize the education system, we can serve the entire world. Here, we are talking about going to a different country and settling there. That's not the end goal. We should be able to serve the entire world with the human resources that we have, with the effectiveness that we have. So that should be the ultimate goal for each and every one of us. One final question to all of you. This is something which I really like. How many of you believe in something called rebirth, like being born again? If you can raise your hand. Yes. OK, a few hands. OK. Consider this. Let's all believe in rebirth. Okay, we are born again as a new baby. Okay, again, we have to go the Indian education system. How many of you will be interested? Okay, not even a single hand. Think about this. Not even a single person. I've experienced this. I've asked a lot of people as well. No one is interested to go through this education for 12 plus 4 years. In no way. Yes, but that is what the future the existing generation is going through. If we are not interested, if I am not interested in doing the education again, if it's not exciting for me, if it's not joyful for me, then you are asking your children to do that. Saying that, okay, I went through that, now it's perfectly fine for me. You can also go through that. Yeah? But if you have to born again, think about this, you won't do this. So this is the challenge. The lot of problems in the world, if we think about rebirth, it will get solved. For example, environment, if we say that we are going to keep it as green as possible for the future generation, we'll be like, we will enjoy and let the future generation take care of themselves. Think about if you are going to get a rebirth, if you want the earth to be on the same way, you will do what's needed. So this is the final question that I had for you. And change is possible, and change is possible with all of us joining together. Education is the place which needs a lot of support, which needs a lot of people. And we want as many people to enter into the field of education and to experience and explore and to provide your ideas. So feel free to connect with me. I'm really grateful for this opportunity to all the organizers. Thank you so much. I hope this particular thing inspired to take one step towards education. And in case if all of you are reborn, you want to have, all of us should have an enjoyable education system. And I particularly don't want to read the cockroach digestive system again. Yes, thank you so much.